So welcome to University of Nairobi for the first years. And University of Nairobi has a lot of opportunities and challenges at the same time. And that is why this orientation week is a very, very important week. And even before I say a lot, let me thank the team who are in charge of orientation week for organizing these activities and making it beautiful and lovely to have fellowship together, even as we orient the first years. It is of interest to note that in your stay here for 4 years, there will be a lot of opportunities that you will experience, and also you will grow tremendously in every way. And I think that is the reason why we have to begin this orientation week with a greater love. Because once we miss that love, then our goose is cooked. A young man by the name Captain Jones was navigating a big naval ship. And this big naval ship was actually a warship. And the warship had everything needed for war, from artillery to aircraft, to very, very strong and powerful weapons. And he had navigated the ocean for years, but one time he got lost in the open sea at 3 in the morning. And when he got lost in the open sea at 3 in the morning, after like 30 minutes of his navigation, he saw a sharp light ahead of him. And a man who was navigating a big naval ship went to his command post and gave orders as a military man. And he said to the sharp light ahead of him, he thought, of course, this must be another vessel that is in the ocean coming. And he gave orders to the ship. He told the vessel ahead of him, please turn your course 5 degrees to the north. And after some few minutes, a few seconds, a response came back. And the response was, no, sorry, you turn your course, the course of your vessel, 5 degrees to the south. And Captain Jones, navigating a big naval ship, did not take that politely. So he said, this is Captain Jones speaking. And he gave the credentials, his credentials as an army officer, and also the credentials of the naval ship he was navigating, just to tell his opponent that I am not your age mate. I am navigating a bigger machine. And the opponent was equally stubborn. And he said, regardless of your credentials, please turn your vessel 5 degrees to the south. And Captain Jones was irritated. And he gave the final command, and that was 4 in the morning. And he said, this is the final command from Captain Jones. Please turn your vessel 5 degrees to the north. And what he received was also equally interesting. And he was told, and this is the final communication from the lighthouse. Please turn your vessel 5 degrees to the south. Then Captain Jones, with all his pride and the big naval ship he was navigating, noticed that kumbe, I was giving wrong commands to a wrong command point. Because the lighthouse is the place that is responsible for giving direction to the vessels in the oceans so that they can navigate safely to a safe harbor. And a lighthouse is not in the ocean, it is in the land. So they know that the person who is going to crash is not the lighthouse, it is the ship, the vessel. As you join the University of Nairobi in first year, there will be so many command posts that you will be getting. There will be a lot of issues a lot of voices that will be giving different commands. And tonight, as we hit the road in these 4 years to come, we are reminding ourselves of the greater love. That always listen to command posts from this greater love that has loved us so much to the point of giving himself for our redemption. Allow me to read first the Gospel according to John. Our theme verse comes from verse 13 of chapter 15. But let me ask kindly the guy in ICT to put on the screen John chapter 15. Let's begin from verse 9 all the way to 17 so that we get a bit of a background. John 15, verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. 11. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. 11. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. 13. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. 17, and the last one, this is my command: love each other. The theme for this orientation week is the greater love. And why the greater love? Because we live at a time and a place in the world where love for many is fading away. Interesting statistics was done in the US, and it had very, very interesting results. But even before we get to the statistics, in 1994 to the year 2004, there was a program that used to run in TV that was called Friends. And in this program that was called Friends, it was about three young men and three women who lived in the same apartment or complex in New York. They shared their joys, their struggles, their love, but they were not about sticking their noses in other person's business. Why? Because friendship is challenging. So they say there are buttons in my life that I will not allow you to touch. And when I tell you don't touch those buttons, please don't touch. And when you touch the buttons, you lose friends because this love in this world fades away. The statistic that was done by a team of insurance in the US and presented a report that was called Dudge Report revealed loneliness as a big epidemic in the United States. And the interview, that was conducted featured like 20,000 people or respondents who are adults of 18 years and above. And this was the outcome. The first was that nearly half of Americans reported sometimes or always feeling all alone. That was like 46% of the respondents said there are moments in life that I feel all alone. Though you're in a crowd of people, you feel all alone. One in four Americans, that is translating to 27%, rarely or never feel as though there are people who really understand them. Does that sound familiar? That sometimes you feel that nobody understands me. Today, not another day, today, I was talking to a member of staff here who told me a long story about a child who says, nobody understands me in this family. And he says, I've tried everything, but he's still convinced that nobody understands him in their family. Come on. Two in five Americans sometimes or always feel that their relationships are not meaningful. That is like 43%. And so they are isolated from others. But this relationship is not going anywhere, so I pull out. I get isolated from other people. One in five people report that they rarely or even never feel close to people. That is 20%. Or feel like there are people they can talk to. They say, there's nobody, no people here. Whom can I talk to? No people. They feel all alone. Only about half of the Americans, that is 53%, have meaningful personal social interaction, such as extended conversations with friends. And this survey revealed that there are several important bright spots that human beings are by nature social beings. And being in a community is important. As we do our orientation week this week and remind ourselves about the greater love, we are also reminding ourselves, and especially the first years who are joining, that human beings are social beings. As you get into the university, please interact with people. Don't feel all alone. There are people you can share. And why the greater love? Because in the world in which we live, love fades away. A young lady who had just been married and was expecting her first child in Kenya, not anywhere else, in Kenya, was tricked by a friend that, you know, when you are expectant, even if you play with your husband, he will not do anything. He will not pick you up, he will not do anything because you are expectant. I know you don't understand that language. I am a father of three. So I understand that language. And so the lady was expectant and she decided to behave, you know, in a funny way to her husband. And when the husband reprimanded her that, what are you doing? She says, kwani unataka kunipiga, si unipige. And the man could stomach that for some time. But remember, the world in which we live, love fades away. That is why we desire a greater love that is beyond the domain that we live here on earth. And one time when the man could no longer stomach that, what he did was terrible, and it was captured in the newspaper. He kicked that pregnancy 32 times. He kicked the pregnancy 32 times. And when the lady had collapsed on the ground, he went into the house, came back with a panga and chopped her into many pieces. The lady is still waiting for resurrection to this day. To prove the theory that love in this world fades away. We desire a greater love. And unfortunately, love is one of the most abused words in English language. Love has been given so many definitions. In fact, listen to some of the definitions that people have given about love, which I'm not talking about that kind of love. One poet said, love is a rose. You know the rose? Love is a rose. is a rose, is a rose. End of quote. Another one said, love is as many splendid things. End of quote. Another one said, love is all you need. End of quote. And we say a lot about love. But is that the love that we are talking about tonight? The greater love? No, we are not talking about that. People will say, I love what I ate for dinner. Is that love that you are talking about? Or we might love the sport team that we follow in football or whichever game that we like. And for me, wrestling, of course. But is that love that you are talking about? In this passage, Jesus Christ gives us the love. And this love is called the greater love. And it has very interesting characteristics. This greater love has very interesting characteristics that I will bring to our attention shortly. From the context of this passage, Jesus is talking with the disciples in the upper room on the night before his crucifixion. And the action of Last Supper, which John talks about, is the passing. He talks about it quickly in passing. He talks about the washing of disciples' feet and the farewell discourse that is recorded in chapter 14 to chapter 17, which also serve as his last will and testament. But the disciples were also about to be faced by absolute devastation. When Jesus is arrested, he's tried, he's crucified, and Jesus prepares them for these eventualities. But remember what happens when Jesus was faced with this. The love of many, including some of his close friends, faded. Like Peter said, me, I go back to my business. I go back fishing. My net is still at home. I had put it nicely, I had kept it nicely in the store. I go for my business. Love sometimes fades. But in this passage also, we are reminded of love that is interesting. And there are some things about love that John talks about that I'll bring to our attention, some characteristics of this greater love. And I'll bring like four characteristics to our attention. And I will also link it up to the love that is mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 to 8. Why talk about love more extensively? Because there will be a lot of love that you will experience in the course of your studies, which is not the love that I'm talking about. I mean, there will be a lot of love that you will experience in the course of your studies, which is not the love that I'm talking about. First years don't understand that language. But thank God that you have a chaplain here who will listen to you when you're in second year. When you say, that man broke my heart, and you shed your tears, and thank God I have some water in my office. I'll be supplying some cold water so that that kawaru that sticks here goes in into the stomach and settles there. This was laughing for free, and they have gone through the same, you know. That is not the love I'm talking about. This is a greater love. And this greater love has the following characteristics. Number one, which I bring to our attention, I have this Chinese phone of mine here to help me keep time. Not because not anybody wants to call me. Nobody wants to call me. Nobody. I mean, even if they call, they are wasting their time. Four characteristics about this love. Number one, it is great love because it is unique love. It is unique love. Why is it unique? It is unique because it is sacrificial. Jesus says he is the only one who lays down his life for the loved one. This love is unique because it is sacrificial. Jesus left his home in glory. he left everything, I mean everything, because of love and came down to us. That is why it is a greater love. It is sacrificial. It's very unique. It is sacrificial. The love that the world offers is not sacrificial. When Celine Dion sings a song, you know, there was a song that Celine Dion sang one time, and she said, I will swing across the oceans just to be with you. I mean, you know the ocean. I stopped swimming in the ocean. I left for the ship to use. I swim in the swimming pool, not the ocean. And Celine says, I will swim across the ocean just to be with you. Really? When the rubber meets the road, that love will leave you. Atakuacha kwa mata. At a critical time. And I'm not a prophet of doom. I'm just saying facts that are there. I mean, if a pastor could be left, how much more for a condo? How much more for a condo? That is not the love I'm talking about. That's not the love I'm talking about. That somebody could leave you in Mata, you know? And you stand as though you have been electrocuted. You don't know what just happened. That's my story. That's my story. Somebody left me 5 minutes to my preaching in South Coast on a phone call. I'm sorry, it is over. And I took a glass of cold water and went to the pulpit and preached Christ crucified. That is not the love I'm talking about. That at a critical time it leaves you. This love is unique because it is sacrificial. It leaves everything. When that time comes, when the love of this world fades away, do not approach a Rob for negotiation. That, you know, Rob, I have a neck here that I can offer freely. Can we strike a deal? When that time comes, know that there is a greater love, and this love is unique because it is sacrificial. And sacrificial means it can lay everything down for the sake of the loved ones. And that is what Christ did. A story is told of a warthog. Do you call it a warthog or a warthog? That one. People, literature guys will tell us what it is. And the warthog went and saw a tree that was full of ripe berries. And he noticed that my little ones really want these berries, but there's no way a warthog can climb a tree to get the berries. And so the warthog reversed. He said, I'll only use the tool that I have. That is my energy. It went, it engaged the reverse gear, and then it engaged a very strong forward gear, accelerating at a speed of how many kilometers an hour? That one. And came and hit the tree. Of course, the tree shook, and a few berries fell down for the young one, and then warthog went rolling on the other side dead because of the impact. That is sacrificial. That's sacrificial. That is sacrificial. That's sacrificial. This love, the greater love that we are talking about, is unique because it is sacrificial. It leaves everything for the sake of the loved ones. Number two, Jesus talks about this love because it is also great love because it is unconditional. It is unconditional. We live in a world where there is nothing for free. There is nothing for free. This one is not having any condition. Jesus loves everyone who accepts him as Lord and Savior for free. In fact, he loved Saul of Tarsus. A man with a very dirty past. He loved him so much that when he encountered Jesus Christ, he changed and became an apostle of Christ. This love is great because it is unconditional. When you get to a situation where you feel your back is against the wall, know that there is a greater love that is unconditional. That when this gentleman or this lady tells you, and for your information, it is over. And you know, they don't tell you on phone call, they write you a very short text message. By the way, it's over. You know, very rude text. No salutation, no conclusion, nothing. By the way, it is over. When you feel like collapsing down, remember that this love that Christ has given us is unconditional. It's unconditional. It goes beyond our situations. I'm talking about this because young people, the young generation of the time, go through these challenges every day. And they need to be pointed constantly to that love that is unconditional, that greater love, that is unique and sacrificial, that is unconditional. When somebody leaves you, you say, thank God that I have a God who loves me, I have friends who are genuine and love me, and I have a life to live. The reason why my being dropped did not cause me to crash in that situation is because I knew even this one would still go. There's a greater love. And you think it was easy. No, it wasn't easy. You think it was easy to forgive that and move on. No, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy. After she surprised me to visit home for Christmas, and so my parents knew that there's a friend of pastor somewhere. And then you are left in Mata. And I did not know how to go and tell them that that one has gone. And I waited for like almost a whole year. And one time when I was home, Mama asked me, and how is she doing? She mentioned the name. How is so-and-so doing? I said, she's doing fine, but you know, she went to her husband. And Mama told me in Kikale, Mutialakwani. And I said, Kongoi, that is the only thing I wanted the most from her. It is unconditional. The love that Christ has given us is a greater love because it is unconditional. Unconditional. Number three, this love is greater love because it is unlimited. It is unlimited. It cannot be depleted. It is unlimited. It continues extending to everybody every day. Even that worst criminal that you think he has no place in the kingdom, when he turns from his sin today, that love is still sufficient for him. It is unlimited. And that is a greater love. You can't say that actually the love that God has given us is now finished. It's over. No, it is unlimited. It continues to flow every day. And it is continuously flowing to everybody who accepts him as Lord and Savior. It is unlimited. The fourth characteristic of this love is that it is great love because it is universal. It is universal. Universal, I mean, it cuts across the race divide. A man, a woman saved in Africa, in Kenya, is as important to God as a man or woman saved in Mongolia. He is as important as a man or woman saved in South America or Brazil, for example, or Brazil. Is as important. It cuts across the race divide. It also cuts across cultural divide. It cuts across cultural divide. It is universal. You cannot say that these people from this particular culture are loved more by God than these people from this particular culture. The love of God is universal. It cuts across all these cultures because it is a greater love. It also cuts across gender, the gender divide. When the Bible says, for God so loved the world, it is not the trees, it is not the animals, it is not the chicken. It is human beings, both men and women. It cuts across all the genders. And this love is just universal. And you'll notice something interesting about this love, the greater love, that Paul, even after coming from a very dark past, as he encountered Jesus and his life was changed completely, this is what he says about this greater love in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I would kindly ask that you put it on the screen, chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. I will read from verse 4 to 8. Chapter 13, let's read from verse 4. This is the characteristic, another characteristic of this greater love. Paul says, love is patient. Love is patient. In fact, this one is what I call the patient character of love. This greater love is patient. And the word translated patient in Greek is actually the word makrothumia. And makrothumia means staying put under immense pressure. The patient character of love. This greater love stays put under immense pressure. That even when your loved one, the people who you love so much, have hurt you so much that you cannot even sleep, you still say, I still love them, though they have hurt me. It is patient. And this patient is staying put even in extreme situations. When you feel like bursting, you say, I can't burst because I am their chaplain and they don't need to see the other side of me. I have to stay put. But remember, know that I don't have any feelings, know that I don't have any emotions, know that I don't know how to do some bit of boxing, but because of you, I stay put. That is the patient character of love. Staying put even in extreme provocations. It also talks about love being kind, and this is the kind character of love. It responds to issues with kindness. If you are asked what is your name, you respond with kindness. You don't say, ulitaka iitwe nani? Kwani ulitaka niitwe nani? Ninafanana na nani kwa uso ukiona? The patient character of love, the kind character of love, responds to others with kindness. Especially at this season, under a lot of pressure, when you are reporting, the first years are reporting, a lot of things are going up and down. You don't know how to get the room, you don't know how to, you know, a lot of things are going on in your mind, and somebody approaches you. That brother, how did you maneuver the registration part on the other side? Love, being kind, responds with kindness. You don't say, kwani mimi ni ukiniona mimi ndio university, so wewe ujipange huko wewe. The patient character of love. It responds to issues with kindness. This is the greater love. It talks about love, it does not envy. It does not envy. And in fact, this one is love now described negatively. Negatively, what love does not do. If you find envy, know that there is no greater love there. Where envy is present, that greater love is absent. Because there is no envy in the greater love. When God blesses you and grants you the best, I don't go and have sleepless night. That kwani, Mungu, kwani huyu alikufanyia nini sana, mpaka ukamkumbuka, na mimi nina hustle tu kiasi hii. The greater love says, God, I thank you that you have blessed this gentleman, that you have blessed this lady. I thank you that it has happened to him. You don't have sleepless nights because somebody else was blessed. There was something that was going around in the WhatsApp in the last few months, and it was saying, When you succeed, the only people who genuinely celebrate your success are your parents. The rest of the humanity, forget it. What was that round of WhatsApp doing? It was saying all these kind of love envies. Where there is envy, the greater love is absent. It is not, it doesn't envy. It talks about love not boasting. It does not boast. You know boasting? Boasting me, mimi ndio ule mse. Mimi ndio ule mse. Mse mgani, akwani huku niona kwa TV wewe. Uhuru hapa, mimi hapa. Only to find that he is a nobody, you know. Love does not boast. Because boasting is negative. It is not a characteristic of love. Where you find boast, forget it, love is not there. And it's even important to mention this to the first years. Because when you go to the village, after the first semester, you say, I'm not coming from any. Me ain't come from any institution, you know? The University of Nairobi. With a bit of a slang, you know? And you send the other guys, whom by the grace of God were not allowed to come this way, you send them to the dustbin. Love does not boast. It takes with humility. Where there is boasting, know that love is absent. My time is up already. What's happening with this watch? It also talks about love is not proud. Remember, these are love described negatively. This greater love described negatively. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It even mentions in verse 8. Yeah, it's not self-seeking. No, let's go back to 5. Verse 5, it says, it is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It is not easily angered. The word translated not easily angered in the Greek has the connotation of, you know, people who are short-tempered. Short-tempered are guys whom you say, "Kwani unakaaje?" You have a punch on your face already before you finish that statement. Short-tempered. Those are easily angered. The word translated not easily angered can be directly translated in English as long-tempered, as opposed to short-tempered. That when something provokes this love, it does not respond negatively immediately. It takes time. I have a friend of mine who has this characteristic, that when he is offended, it never clicks in his mind. It never clicks. But wait a minute. He can stay for like 4 hours. Then when he is at home, he is busy eating supper, then he remembers, and what did that guy say? Kwani alinijibuje? How did he respond to me? Kwani, how? Aliona mimi ni mtoto sana, and he gets so mad to the point of leaving food on the table. And in such a situation, when you find somebody, then you know that sanctification is a process for real, you know? Love is not easily angered. As we demonstrate the greater love in the course of our stay here, let us embrace this not easily angered character of love. Because people will offend you. Many people will offend you. Including people in the fellowship, in the body of Christ. They will offend you. They will say things that you will feel offended. But let us clothe ourselves with this character of love that is not easily angered. And not being easily angered, it also talks about the other thing about love. It does not keep a record of wrong. Does not keep a record of wrong. Not keeping a record of wrong is nilikusamea jana, nao merudia. After last week, nilikusamea. After the other week, nilikusamea. This problem of keeping record of wrongs, especially with the house helps. forgives, he forgives. But the wife has told us several that huyu, ikifika point yenye amesema sasa simtaki huyu, ataanza the records of wrongs. And the lady will say, no, I'm sorry, that one is finished. No, but hata hii, mpaka huyu anasema, hapo, wacha mimi wache kazi niende. Love does not keep record of wrongs. In the course of your stay, in studies, interaction, you will be wronged. Do not keep a record of wrong. Learn to let it go. Now, side effects of Chinese phones. Friends, as I conclude in this Christian love, let me bring to our attention these words as our conclusion. That in this life, God is our only source of fulfillment and comfort. In this life, God is the only source of our fulfillment and comfort. Find Him, you find true love. Number two, God is the only one that can give us purpose and direction in life. As we seek this love, let us know that it is only found in God. He is the only one who can give us purpose and direction in life. Number three, and the final one, God is the only one that reveals our ultimate goal in life. God is the only one that reveals our ultimate goal in life. And I conclude by saying, greater love has no one than this, that someone laid down his life for friends. Jesus was such a person, and he wants us to become such persons also as his followers and as the body of Christ in the church as we live each day. That we will live in such loving relationships in this lonely world and demonstrate that we actually belong to a God who has shown us a bigger love, a greater love, by dying on the cross. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, it is still time to consider that greater love, because He's still calling and saying, come. May the Lord bless you. May He be gracious to you. May He constantly walk with you in this journey for the first years, and for all those other years who are continuing, may His face constantly shine upon you as you walk this journey. May the Lord.